What are we doing this? You know the story, so I won't spend much time on this. I mean, what NFME promises is to go from a traditional network management, which is based purely on some stages that are related to physical steps. I mean, you need to install some equipment in one occasion, you need to enable some basic configuration that can be controlled remotely. And then you operate it on a daily basis, right? So that those makes the traditional stages in operation. The promise of NFV, particularly when you go to a native NFV management, is that you can make this more efficiently because the boundaries between those stages can blur somehow. And still, you don't have an actual differentiation between the zero and the one because they come, I would say, bundled. I mean, you can't understand that anything is deployed until it's not reachable from outside by definition, right? And then leverage on the conveniences of a virtualized environment, you'll see that the two operations should be easier, right? Actually, the idea of all this is that you can combine elements in a manner that is way more convenient than it was in the physical world. So you add a set of elements that make your BNF catalog, and you can combine them to build the network services. You can add more elements via the onboarding process, and you can build your network service with a description. So everything is can be fairly automated in this framework, right? Well, not really. I mean, that is a good idea. So I'll suggest you one. I'd like to start with a reflection here. You see two space shadows here. Which one would you choose? The one on the left and the one on the right. So both of them were designed in the 60s. So equal here, right, in terms of features. So both will make same thing the RFQ. The first one is can travel faster than 8 times light speed, which is pretty cool. The other is much slower, unfortunately. So it can barely make 37 millionth of light speed, being lucky, okay, at top speed. The one on the left is much bigger than a football pitch. Much, much bigger. Uncomfortable for tens of crew members. And the one on the right might be slightly bigger than an open kitchen, being lucky, and terribly uncomfortable for just 3 people. The one on the left have had the public interested for decades, while the one on the right was interesting for just a few days, around 8-10 days at most. In the one on the left, you can wear comfortable clothes. But in the one on the right, you can just, you are only allowed to wear outdoor outfits. Otherwise, you'll die. The point is that the one on the left never flew for real, while the one on the right can bring you to the moon and return safely. So if I had to skip that the last line, it's likely that you had chosen the one on the left. I would, right? But what makes it interesting is that single detail. So reality is not always as pretty as we would like. So if you want TV series, I mean, this is relative. I mean, what are you looking for? I mean, you are looking for TV series, definitely go to the left, the one on the left. Making a TV series on the right is pretty boring, right? But if you want to go to the moon for real, you definitely need to go to Apollo 11. You get the point, right? So what's out there then? What is the reality? Is that operating a real virtualized network is not as simple as I mentioned at the beginning. It's a bit uglier because you need to deal with multiple sites with a variety of technologies. you're seeing different sites here with some combination of technologies. Actually, you're seeing that even some of the sites here, the site 1, site 3, and site 2, are apparently using the same technology, but with completely different configurations. So there are things that here could be optimized for IO-intensive workloads, while here you'll have high-density workloads, which is different. You want to put more VMs in a location, and here the point is that you want to get the right IO performance, and here you want to optimize for latency, maybe for Cloud RAN, right? And then you have another technologies here, I mean, as examples, including the public cloud, which is part of the picture. So in case that we want to achieve the goals that I mentioned at the beginning, we need to take that into account. It's more complex than Lego pieces, right? And if you zoom in one of those locations, the reality is even more complicated. I mean, you have one of the sites, you have a combination of the infrastructure and the beam that is quite complicated in terms of the variety of NICs, the variety of servers, the variety of hypervisors, and even the beam technology, right? The same happens with the SDN, by the way. And not talking about the applications, in our case, the VNF, right? Where you have, of course, a variety of interfaces that you are requesting, but also a variety of configuration methods. There's no convergence here. And it's unlikely that will happen anytime soon, okay? You have Ansible, Jang, Spect, others. And one last thing is that, okay, but I have the orchestration that will solve it. The problem is that the orchestration does, unless you are ready to embrace the layering approach here, it can make your life more complicated than it was. Because this is the theory, you ask for a deployment, and then the NFV orchestration translates somehow to anything that is beam dependent, right? The reality is that what you get in a lab when you test commercial and real VNFs is that you need to make all these manual steps to get it ready for day two operation, right? So this is the exact opposite of zero touch operation, right? The modeling is not helping here because we were supposed to have a modeling that allow us to do that without any human intervention, but actually the modeling is quite uneven in practice. So you are finding it's a hard onboarding process. You have a VNF catalog that doesn't look like a set of Lego pieces, unfortunately. The way that you can describe your network service is a bit rough. So if you are lucky, with a lot of effort, you get something like this. So you won't get the castle. We have seen probably this a couple of times before. Okay, so now we know that the reality is ugly. So the question is, how are you planning to take me to the moon then? Because you wanted to take me to the moon, right? So the point is that what OSM is doing is trying to focus on what we have in common across different deployments. OSM is not trying to boil the ocean, creating an end-to-end architecture, or choosing one of the pieces in each of those boxes. OSM is embracing that complexity and that reality, okay? Because the world looks like that. So here you have three different service providers architectures, which have tried to be as accurate as possible. And they do not look alike. Besides having a layer of OSS and BSS and having some infrastructures in plural. So what you have in the middle is the mano stack. It's what you have in common, right? You have multiple technologies, and actually, who said that having choices was bad? No, actually having choices is good. It was one of the reasons why we started this journey in NFV, precisely because we wanted to have more choices, not less. So if you want choices, let's embrace having choices. So we'll need to plan and engineer according to the an open set of choices. So of course we want to leverage on the work of CNFV. It would be a pretty bad idea that we said that everything else that has happened before, say, a given initiative has started, is useless. I think it would be really brave saying that. On the contrary, we think that is a lot of value in what's been created in HNV. You want to preserve it. We want to be ready to support greenfield and brownfield deployments. I mean, greenfield is in a future that never arrives. When you get to that greenfield, there's a brownfield there. Okay. Of course, in order to make the math and make many of the business cases, you need to be able to guarantee some performance on SLAs. Particularly, need to make sure that these two orders of magnitude are preserved for IO intensive workloads. That is interesting. And here the point is that open source becomes a tool to facilitate that convergence. It's not a mean, it's a tool to achieve that. Okay. Why open source? First, because it helps us to accelerate the availability of a reference standard. And it's something that you can disagree with. You can test it, you can request for new things to be added, but it's something concrete. It's very obvious what it offers. Okay, and that can go hand to hand with more formal approaches of standards. So it fits pretty well if you manage to understand the complementarities, right? As a byproduct of this process, you are building something that actually works, so you can enable a wider competitive market as well. Both of producers of that technology, but also people who will leverage on the existence of that reference framework to offer their products more conveniently, right? And sometimes for anyone who is worried about the progression of innovation, sometimes you need to ask you this question, whether I want to buy the innovation, I want to make it, because otherwise I need to maintain it, right? Because if I buy, I know that I have a product. If I make it, I have a solution, and it would be harder to maintain it. So here, open source can work as a bridge as well. So there are three reasons to go to open source, but not just any open source. I mean, not just open source is a tool, as I said. So it's not magic. And you need to make sure that it serves the purpose. So there are some keys here. One is that it should be open to all players of all sizes. And that is very important if you want to embrace that diversity. And add that expertise as well. So, because it's an active buying process, what you are looking for, right? In terms of what is developed, it needs to be sustainable and reliable. I mean, it needs to work, and you need to build trust around that code base. So the leaner, the better, right? And you need to focus on the core things. Or you should avoid doing what already exists, what is already invented and works fine. As much as you can. And there the approach is not about creating everything bottom up, but about interoperability. Okay. Of course, it should be future proof. So it shouldn't be closed and frozen at one point in time. It should evolve. And very important, it should be ready to deliver. I mean, we want to change the reality. We want to go to the moon and not be in a TV city. So that is, those are the premises. So what does OSM provide in practice here? So what OSM provides is a production quality nanostack that is capable of consuming, very important, very central here, an openly published information model, a very specific information model that is available for everyone, is suitable in principle for all kind of VNFs, is operationally significant, which means that it facilitates our work. It doesn't make it more complicated than it was before in a physical world. And it's been independent, which is quite relevant from the perspective of what I was saying of the diversity of technologies that you'll find in the real world. It's aligned to the NFV-ISG information model, which doesn't mean that you have a pipeline there or anything like that. It's simply that it's getting closer and it's providing feedback as it discover new stuff, and it's enabling an ecosystem of IAM client BNF vendors. That is the whole point. Okay. The approach in OSM means that all the information that you require is encapsulated. All the know-how is encapsulated in bits. So that means that whichever that you are developing in your local environment, whichever that you do in the Hackfest during this week, you can do it in your laptop, and you will see that. And the thing is that you are developing with some packages or descriptors or whatever, and a set of images the same descriptors and packages can be immediately reused to test it in a large pool and bring them to production environment with no transition there. Okay. So that is precisely what it enables, that marketplace. Okay. And it's IM driven, which means that the information model drives the behavior of the system. So if you have two key pieces, which in OSM, a set of BNF packages, each coming from each of the BNF vendors, and an NS package where I describe how my network service is supposed to work. And they have two components here, something that is more related to the resources and something that is more related to the management procedures. Both of them are quite important here. Because you have a rough description of the resources of the BNF and how this, the combination of BNFs are stitched. So that goes to one line in OSM and leverage on the set of BIM plugins. Here, it's able to request whatever that is needed to the beams that are attached to OSM. So they take over and they deploy what you are requesting. On the other hand, all the management procedures are very important because it's what you will do at the beginning to get it up and running and reachable to be operated later, and also enable all the day two operations. That is what is bundled here, which goes via this branch. And here you have the CHAN framework, which is the one that makes the magic of translating to every single configuration method that that the BNF require. Okay. And as I said, very important, OSM is ready to work with different type of beams, but also with different type of infrastructure and different type of OSS. It's not making any assumption about the OSS that you have above it. Because what needs to be common is in the middle of that sandwich, essentially. What is OSM scope? OSM scopes is, by definition, whichever that you need in order to accomplish that objective. Just one architecture that I understand that is rather well known, and I won't spend much on the details because these kind of things are revisited per release, and we are 1 month away from the next release, but it's pretty much reflecting what I explained before in terms of the organization. It also has one set of design time tools that will facilitate the creation of those descriptors, which do not belong to the architecture of anything, but it's something very convenient to have. And this is the summary. OSM community has managed to be really large and diverse, with 94 companies as of today, unless that I've not checked my inbox lately. So it should still be 94 companies, with 11 global service providers, which includes also Amazon, which falls into that category, according to how we classify the participation in OSM, and a large set of companies, as you can see here, from leading players from the cloud, from the infrastructure, from the OSS even, from many BNF vendors, from system integrators, almost everyone who is participating here. We are really glad of that diversity as well. Academia, there we have very good contributions from the academia as well very lately. So we're really proud of that. And in spite that it has many members, it's open to fellow travelers. The procedure is quite simple to join, and it's essentially the same that you can find in any other Etsy committee, so it's open for Etsy members, but also non-Etsy members. Okay, so that is how it works, and that is what is it works in theory. So where are we in that journey to the moon? Well, OSM is about to deliver its fifth release. We started counting by zero, so that's why the release 4 will be the fifth one. I'm sorry for that. But we needed to have something geeky. Okay, so the thing is that we, as you are seeing, that we are not only launching and improving the maturity, as you will see later, but also we've been actively engaged in challenges that were out of our control. We wanted to test ourselves how well or how bad we were doing in that journey to the moon. So we participated in the first, let's see, NAV plug test as early as January 2017. In that case, we participated as community, and we've just participated in the second, let's see, NAV plug test, now with some commercial distros based on OSN. And they've been really kind to share their findings with the community. There was one declaration of production readiness right after, and now we are planning for our next release, which is release 4. Okay. Just to give you a sense of how much is the impact of each of these releases, if we take release 2, we have not closed the number for release 3, is that it had more than 10,000 installations and upgrades, over 6,000 downloads, and it was installed in more than 70 countries, which is quite impressive, in my opinion. And both release 2 and 3 brought a really large set of capabilities that allow you to do almost anything that you might possibly want. Okay, so the support of multiple beams is there. The support of multiple SDN types is there. The combination of both, very very important for underlay and controlling physical assets, is there. The control of some dynamicity on the network services, we are working on that, and you'll see improvements in the next release, but this is there. The of course, the deployment of multi-site network services that are deployed across a large infrastructure is there. And the support of course, of all the day zero, day one, day two operations was there. And a one-click installer that is very important, because that is our way to facilitate that just anyone can test OSM and give us their opinion. That was extended with more advanced capabilities for collaborative control in the latest release. So there's support for tenants and role-based access control. There was some support that back then was experimental, and there will be big advancements in release 4. Something that was very very important here is that the way that the ports were managed, we improved substantially in the last release. The way to manage resiliency in VNS was improved as well. And it also included, of course, whichever new technology that is out there. We were quite lucky to have a huge engagement from VMware to make sure that VMware Integrated OpenStack 4 could be tested before it was launched. They were testing it actively, so you could make sure, they could make sure that whenever that was commercially available, it was already in the interoperated rather well with OSM back then, okay? And also, in order to enable the community to test it, it can include a Beano emulator. It's just one of the contributions from academia that has been quite important to enable a larger community. We'll have one dedicated presentation on our CI/CD environment. I won't spend much on time, but we are taking very seriously our approach to interoperability. And that means that if we say that we are interoperating with a large set of technologies, we'd better test it, right? And better test it on a continuous basis. That's what we do. And it's something that is rather new in OSM, is that you have your CI/CD environment, but it does not operate in isolation. But it works and interacts with a set of remote labs that are distributed over the world. You'll see more details later, so I won't make a spoiler about how it works. And well, something that we're quite proud of is that in the last SDN World Congress, we were lucky to be, we were awarded as the best open source development of the year. We're really proud, and that's encouraging, but also tell us that we need to keep up the good work, because it's been perceived as we feel from its side, so this is great. And the thing is that now you can close the project because it's done, right? No, of course, it's not the intention, because whenever that there is software, there is room for improvement. There are new technologies that always come, and you need to accommodate them because they are relevant, or you will be out of the relevancy very quickly. So we are quite conscious about that. And of course, we promise that we'll keep delivering bugs. So we have something to fix later, okay? So the things that OSM is open to feedback to make it better, as I said. So there are things that we discover as we go that make the system better, and that's great. More than, as I said, all that amount of people testing OSM are bringing a lot of useful feedback, which we really appreciate. We don't take it as an annoying set of emails that we need to reply. It doesn't look like that. On the contrary, it helps us actively to discover things that we didn't know, and otherwise we'll need an unbounded amount of resources to test them ourselves and discover them ourselves. Okay, the one all-in-one installer is being really essential for this. So one of the lines where we are working and investing a lot is to make it even more convenient and even simpler to use. OSM is really committed to optimize code efficiency, and I think that this is a key point. It's not about pushing software, it's about pushing software of quality. So other people can make their products out of it, and someone is willing to use it in production network. Okay. So we are quite conscious about that, and if you see the line, across the releases of OSM, starting from the seed code, we've been continuously reducing the RAM footprint. This is just one of the examples, okay? It's not, but I think this one is very easy to follow. We've been reducing the RAM footprint at the same time that we've been increasing the functionality. And we'll keep doing that, okay? Obviously, less than this probably will not make much sense, but the optimization has always a room here for many reasons, because you need to make it lean in order to make it sustainable, and because you want to make it efficient. Okay. Just to put things in perspective, it's the same picture. Okay. So it's about 170 less footprint than something else. Okay. So, one in touch with the reality is that we were present in the latest NFV plug test. And again, this is a lot of effort, a lot of work. It's not an activity that is immediately rewarding, because you don't get any traffic in a booth or anything like that. It's just pure technical progress and pure technical learning. And you go there to discover things that do not work well, which is not the most appealing experience at the beginning, at least, right? But it's really important to mature a project for real. So you see that OSM in this time did not go as community. It was represented by two OSM-based distros, commercial distros. So we should give them a lot of credit, because they were kind enough to provide feedback to the OSM community afterwards, after all the work that they invested, to tell essentially what they wanted to change and improve for release 4. It's worth noting that no other commercial distros were based on open source projects participating there. Okay, there were some open source projects from the academia, but nothing else on that aspect. And leverage on the good thing is that it leveraged a lot in community experience, because there was a wealth of BNF descriptors that were already out there that could be refined, extended, or whatever. But we had a solid basis to work, and the interoperability, something that is a premise, was guaranteed with the beams and the NFVIs via the plugin framework of OSM. So all that work was saved. And some of the new release 4 functionality was conceived precisely there. Okay. All that while we keep enabling the ecosystem to use OSM better and better. So we had our first OSM hackfest co-located precisely with that plug test. So it was twice as much as work, covering mostly BNF onboarding and D0, D1, D2 operations. So I mean, these subjects are unlimited, so probably if we had to spend 2 weeks there, it would be interesting. But the thing is that, the point is that we managed to have a set of people who were happy to have attended the whole week. And so it made us confident to organize a new Hackfest quite close to that one, which is not usual. And we organize it here. Actually, it will start tomorrow here in Madrid. It's co-located with this event, and will be running in Intel premises because we need some special type of connectivity. It's not a simple event in terms of technology that you need to build. You need to provide connections to some infrastructures, etc. But the thing is that we organize it because we thought that we owed some additional time for hands-on activity, seeing the success here. The good or bad news is that the room capacity has been reached weeks ago, there's been a waiting queue even to add. So, but the good news is that it's likely that we'll organize a third event anytime soon. Okay. Key directions and wrapping up is that we want to make better the platform deployment, more convenient, and set a path for redundancy for commercial distros. You'll see huge improvements in the part of service assurance and monitoring in the next release. The user experience, we keep on improving the user experience. We know that there's a lot to do to make it more convenient, more efficient for the end user, more intuitive. We know that, but we are the first step is to be aware of it. Testing will keep playing a central role in OSM, as you may imagine. Of course, we'll promote all the contributions that deserve some credit, and there are some really awesome contributions on the pipeline. Of course, we don't want to let go the opportunity to extend the base of users. So we want to make sure that the more feedback we have, the better. Okay. And of course, keep explaining what we do, but this is what we are doing right now. Okay. What we want to preserve, of course, keep being efficient, keep the pace of delivery. We don't want to change that at all. We want to keep following those OSM architectural principles because we understand that they are the right one in terms of scope, in terms of ambition, in terms of what we are trying to achieve. Something that we are doing in OSM as well is that we are opinionated. We can change our mind on one aspect, but we need to take choices, otherwise our actual software does not work. So we want to make sure that our approach is always consistent. And of course, we can do better. Of course, you learn as you go that you can. I mean, we started with 23 companies. Now we are almost, quickly approaching to 100. So the way that we organize the community with 23 companies is obviously different from the way that we are organizing the community right now. And of course, the technical competence can be rewarded by empowerment in OSM, as in any other community. This is not new in OSM, but it's something that is core as well. Okay. If you want to learn more, of course, you can give a try to OSM Release 3 for the time being. You can read the OSM Release white paper that is available out there. And you cannot, in case that you have not registered in the Hackfest this week, at least you can download all the contents from the previous Hackfest that are still available there, including the examples, etc., etc. So you can start some self-learning process. Okay. That's all that I had. Thank you.